Okay, so the first thing to say is that I'm very scared of Benito. I'll speak very fast and abide by the rules. So I'm going to talk to you about the about different development pathways that I think are needed to get well below 2 degrees and on to 1.5. And I think what Lavanya was presenting just before we broke made very clear that, in fact, sustainable development and poverty eradication are very much part of the purpose of the agreement. And because I'm so scared of Benito, I put my key messages up front that before he gives me the red card, at least I will have told you what are the four main points that I wanted to leave you with, and I'll come back to them if I make it at the end again, but hopefully they'll make a bit more sense by then. So the first is in the title, that in fact we need different development pathways to get anywhere to well below 2 degrees. We need to talk about not only mitigation pathways, but mitigation and development pathways, so the emphasis on the and development there. That many of the existing models that we run, also at the national level, at the ERC, may break, as it were. If we push them to 1.5 degrees, we may need to think in different ways, new models, and in fact new ways of thinking, models not just in the quantitative sense. And that we should also understand better the political economy of actors that both oppose and support low carbon development and therefore might enable us to get well below 2 degrees and pursue 1.5. So partly coming to this conference, one of my questions was, is 1.5 degrees the most important or the only only question, because we're spending a lot of time thinking about it. And I don't doubt for a minute that the huge symbolic significance of 1.5 degrees, and I think it's been very clearly articulated, not least by my friend and colleague MJ, in terms of how important that is to the most vulnerable countries. That's not doubted. Anyway, but I think it does have to be understood, and I've chosen just one of the SDGs out of there. We are in a post-2015 world, and we also need to, and I highlight this coming from a country with very high levels of inequality and poverty, we need to eliminate poverty in all its forms everywhere, and doing both of those is very challenging. So a lot of the analysis we have done in the past is we've run national models to try and understand national energy models linked to economy and environment models to try and get to pathways to 2 degrees. And so the easy response to the challenge of 1.5 from that analytical basis would be just to push them even harder. When we ran those models to achieve, and I'll show you some of the results and some of the assumptions that we made in getting there, well, some of the assumptions we made were already amongst our modeling team really, really at the edge of what they would consider plausible. And a meeting I was in Paris last week and doing further work in deep decarbonization, someone described the assumptions that we would make for 1.5 degrees as Harry Potter assumptions, which seems very appropriate in these walls. They look very much like that. And the phrase apparently is expecto decarbonis, right? You do it by magic, right? Slightly more seriously and analytically, we already know the general tenor of the answers of what it will look like at 1.5 or the direction of the answers, and I think we need to think in broader and different ways if we're going to be serious about 1.5, which I think we need to do this. And that just leads me to suggest that we actually need analysis, and this is the development part, so an analysis of alternative development pathways as well as clearly ramped up climate action. Because in a very, very simple figure, if you had a two-way interaction between development, and I'm focusing particularly on mitigation here, adaptation is not my area of expertise, you'd almost certainly make the development bubble bigger than the mitigation. So you think that way around of understanding what the emissions implications are of a development pathway is perhaps the way to think about it. We tend, especially in the global models, to model stabilization, in other words, something climate, but maybe, and especially post-Paris in a world where things are nationally determined, and we have long-term low-carbon development strategies where, at the national level. We need to model development at the national level, and that's what we hope to get better at doing. I don't think we... But modeling doesn't tell us everything. And probably after the lunchtime conversation with Sonja, I would add some more, but she's going to speak herself in the session, which I'm very pleased about. But what we have done is also done some analysis, which we broadly characterize as political economy as a key complement to modeling. So when we see lovely smooth curves coming out of even a national energy economy environment model, the research question put to us, in fact, proposed to us by the people who supported this work was, well, which of those scenarios would actually happen in South Africa, and what would make them happen, which actors would make them happen, and on the other side, which ones would be opposed by which actors in South Africa. So we already know, I think I'm going to skip the first bullet, we already know that the aggregate effects of all the INDCs gives us somewhere in that range. That's a paper that Yuri led. And so I think the first challenge is actually to get from where we are going to well below 2 degrees. In South Africa, modeling in quantitative terms, and I'll show you some of the results in a minute, we translated that into a cumulative constraint on energy CO2 of 14 gigatons from 2015 to 2050. And we try to understand, still in an imperfect way, what the mitigation and development pathways would be. And then in the follow-up study, we asked how those might be realized or not. So I think I can skip this one. So the first was a technical modeling study. And there you can see the... So 14 gigatons energy emissions in this deep decarbonization pathway. We thought we could make a kind of credible claim that's consistent with 2 degrees. Of course, it depends on equity. Whether that's a fair share depends on how you're allocating the global carbon budget. It very unambiguously is a transition away from coal. Our energy system is 70% of our total primary energy supply comes from coal, and 93% of our electricity comes from coal. But what we wanted to look at, and that's, you know, we've done studies on that, many of them, there's nothing new there. What we try to do here is try to also think about what are some of the developmental shifts that would need to take place. And the two that we looked at, the two scenarios that we ran, were one about economic structure, where we assume that South Africa would not have the industrial structure that it currently has. So where, never mind the GDP growth rates, but we assume that greater shares of GDP would come from lower emission sectors. And somewhat to our surprise, after discussions with many economists, different kinds of economists, because there are always many different kinds, we found ourselves thinking a lot about agriculture. Not an area because it's the other main challenge, which is in the next scenario for us, is really about employment. Getting out of poverty really is closely linked to reducing unemployment, which is officially at 24%, but unofficially at probably about 40%. The different definitions. And so the other assumption that we made to run these scenarios was a so-called high-skilled scenario. South Africa, I think, has fairly singularly, perhaps the biggest failure of the post-apartheid government has been not to change the education system sufficiently. And so we assumed a skills base in the population that, again, we currently don't have. And even with all those optimistic assumptions, we fail to meet the challenge we put ourselves. So if the challenge is not just zero emissions, or net zero emissions, but also zero poverty, right, even though Jesus told us the poor will always be with us from later, the best we can do is to get from 24% to 18% unemployment and to 12%. So is 12% unemployment, when we assume a radically different economic structure, is that an acceptable level of unemployment? We think not, and so we don't think we've come to the final answer on this, but this is the kind of analysis we'd like. And this is just, I emphasize again, this is just for 2 degrees. And this is what I mean when I say if we push this even further, to 1.5 and have not a 14 gigaton, but maybe an 8 gigaton carbon budget, then this gets worse. This does not get better. So then just to very briefly say that we're also thinking about the challenges to actually start doing this, even if it seems unrealistic at the moment. And so we've thought a lot in a completely different analytical approach about the actors that might advance such a low carbon future or block it. And this is this kind of second deep decarbonization for South Africa study. What we found is that the so-called transformative alliance, and I'm not going to go into the detail here in the interest of time, but my colleagues actually mapped this. It is there, but it consists of many actors, but relatively weak actors. The renewable energy industry, which is growing, but it's so busy growing and, you know, putting up wind farms and PV plants that they don't spend much time lobbying, even supporting climate policy. Whereas the alliance of incumbents, which is basically the fossil fuel industry, coal mining, coal-based electricity, and coal to liquids, is very well entrenched, very good at lobbying, and basically starting to shift. But yeah, that's how. If you ask the question, what is really in terms of social actors, major social actors in South Africa, the balance is with the incumbents at this point. And I don't see a yellow.
It's coming.
Okay, good, so I can relax a bit because I think I've only got about two or three more slides. So just to say, so we have addressed this question of, as we put it, zero poverty and zero emissions imperfectly. These are just some of the... Okay, he's very intimidating. One of my colleagues says we want to... So many of our models are to many people other than the modelers a black box machine, so there are various ways in which we can improve the current models, the current black box machine, extending linking energy and economy, quantifying uncertainty, doing this development first. But we should also think, and I think this is one of the challenges that we would like to explore with other researchers, developing different kinds of models that actually have development and objective function, whatever that may mean. This is a slide I wanted to show that I got from Professor Zhu Ji here. There's an acknowledgement there where he showed this in a meeting. And there are a couple of things that really struck me about this. So you can see on the y-axis emissions per capita coming from a Chinese researcher, you won't be surprised. But very interesting stages of development. Forget about roster, but these are the Chinese stages of development that end in eco-civilization, very interesting. And the fundamental thesis is that China's emissions will peak at a lower per capita emissions than the US and Australia and Japan and the EU, as you can see, and that is an alternative development pathway. How we get there, I think, is a question we should all explore. We'd like to explore that with him. And I want to end, and this is my last slide, is that I think even more broadly than these issues, or perhaps even more deeply than these issues of quantifying and understanding the social actors, the political economy of that, I think we fundamentally also need to start talking about a new social contract. And what this very simple conceptual slide tries to suggest is that, and there's some missing labels here that somehow dropped off, if these are basically the rich and these are the poor, and this is the middle class, the emissions of the poor don't basically matter. You can provide, at least in South Africa, affordable access to energy without blowing any emissions budget whatsoever. People like me consume too much, mainly in aviation emissions, and we all have to live, actually. As the Bolivarians put it, we have to look at buen vivir, at living well, not living better with more consumption. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Perfect. Stay here for a moment, because you need to sit next to the microphone for the answer.
Oh, you're taking questions now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Two questions, 2 minutes. One, two. One each.
Just very quick clarification, actually.
Speak up, so.
Very quick clarification on the slide that you put up from Zhu Ji. It's not just China peaking at a low per capita emissions, right? It's the average of China, India, and the other emerging economies? Because India is at a third of the per capita emissions of China, and it's likely to be very low. So if it's an average, then it's perhaps not China that's going to be particularly low.
That's a very precise legal reading of a slide, I think, is my one comment. My second comment would be, you'd have to ask Suji. I think you're right that it's labelled as... and I am very confident he wouldn't see China and India as the same. But it's conceptual.
Yeah. Free riding.
It's free riding on some Indian emissions. Yeah. Is that what you
said?
Point taken.
In sacred and protected sites, but also in general, the message coming from the South African government was that they would continue with coal and continue mining wherever they could. So what do you do when you have that kind of a governance obstacle or blockade?
Well, the one reaction is to throw up our hands in horror, but of course, we do politically, so you were speaking to some of those incumbents that they were speaking about. I'm not sure about how many sacred sites, but right now this is a deeply political issue, so some of you may have read in the media that our president is basically fighting with our finance minister. Some of those fights are about coal contracts, and it's about who extracts the rent in polite language.
So. Thank you very much. Look, perfect timing. Now I would like to ask Jean-Pascal van Ypersele, who is professor and former IPCC vice chair at the Université Catholique de Louvain in Belgium, and the Department of the Earth and Life Institute, the Georges Lemaître Center for Earth and Climate Research. Is that right?
That's right.
Excellent. So, same rules.
You can always start when my first slide is on.
He's a very strict person.
Starting.
That's right.
Van Ypersele. Yes.
Cancel this. Okay. Oh, I can see that's right.
Okay. There we go.
Thanks.
Now.
Thanks. Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be at this very exciting conference. Maybe this talk on what did the IPCC say about the 1.5 degree C goal could have come a little earlier in the program. So you have heard some of the aspects of what the IPCC has written over the years. But I will try to highlight maybe a few other aspects that you have not so much heard about over the last 2 days. Just a reminder what the IPCC is. It was created in 1988, not to do additional research on climate change, but to assess the state of knowledge about climate change from all perspectives and using, if possible, all disciplines, looking at the causes of climate change, the evolution of climate change, the projections, the impacts, the possible solutions on the side of adaptation and on the side of mitigation. This is in words. This presentation will, of course, be available afterwards. It's actually already available on my webpage right now, so I'm not going to read everything, but you can, if you need it, go back to the slides. A very important aspect that of the IPCC work is that it needs to be done in a way that's policy relevant, but without being policy prescriptive. And it's sometimes a subtle nuance. Actually, the tie I'm wearing, and a few people are jealous about this tie, is a tie I wore for the first time here. Because when I was vice chair of the IPCC, I couldn't express such love for the 1.5 target. So I received it from some NGO and said, I'll wear it later when I'm authorized to wear it. But the other side of the coin, the IPCC has to be neutral, but it has to be policy relevant. So that's very important that the information it provides, the assessment it provides, needs to be useful for decision making. And the IPCC has, of course, tried to do that over the years, but I believe it can still improve on that in the future. Now, I promise to give you, during this talk, a summary of what the IPCC has said since its first report. So let's start. It's small, so I'll read it. First report, 1990. So this climate change thing could be a problem, is a summary. 95, climate change, definitely a problem. 2001, yes, we should really be getting on with sorting this out pretty soon. Look, sorry to sound like a broken record here. In 2007, 2013, we really have checked and we are not making this up, is the summary of the report. And this is the last one. Is this microphone working? Yeah, yeah. Well, that's what's written there. You're not following. So now, this is a very short summary of what the IPCC has said, but very broadly, not specifically on the 1.5 thing, of course. Now, a small quiz. This quote here, it may require only a very small percentage of change in the planet's balance of energy to modify average temperature by 2 degrees, you have heard that number. Downward, this is another ice age. Upward, a return to an ice free age. In either case, the effects are global and catastrophic. When does this date from? Any guess?
65.
Yeah, very close, very close. This is in the report written to prepare the Stockholm Environment Conference in 1972 at the request of the UN Secretary General by Barbara Ward, who was an Oxford graduate, by the way, and René Dubos, a microbiologist, Nobel Prize winner, in that report called Only One Earth. So you see the 2 degree C number is not a new number, and I think it's interesting to have some historical perspective. Now, there's a tension, and there has always been a tension around either the 2 degree number or the 1.5 degree number between different aspects of what is captured here in the Article 2 of the Convention, which is describing the ultimate objective of the Convention, stabilizing of greenhouse gas concentration, in a way that one would prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference with the climate system. Such a level should be achieved within a time frame sufficient to allow ecosystems to adapt naturally, to ensure that food production is not threatened, and on the other side, because this is on the impact side in a sense, and on the other side, and there's a tension between those two sub-objectives on one side and this one on the other side, to enable economic development to proceed in a sustainable manner. So there has always been, you know, a wish to avoid impacts as much as possible, and of course to have, for that you need to stabilize temperature as low as possible. And on the other side, the concerns of those who want to continue to have as much growth as possible and as much as emissions as possible, and to have development proceeding. Now, sustainable manner is a concession, but it's still proceed, development that's proceeding. Now, where does this number, Article 2 and the later 1.5 degree, come from? Well, actually, you have to look a little bit before the year when IPCC was created in 98, and there were two very important VILAC and very important workshop taking place in VILAC and Bellagio, and actually one of the organizers for those meetings just left. That's Michael Oppenheimer. He's on his way to the airport, but he was one of the organizers of those meetings, and they pointed to the fact that a convention was needed to protect climate, and they also looked at different ways to look at the targets to such a convention would have to pursue. This is the UN General Assembly resolution creating the IPCC, and probably too few people know that this resolution not only called for the IPCC to be created and do all of this, but also asked the IPCC to provide elements for inclusion in a possible future international convention on climate, because the IPCC was created in 88, the convention was adopted in 92. Another very important element in the history was the Norway conference, which was also a little bit outside the IPCC process, but in a way close, because it took place in the Netherlands, and some key IPCC authors were associated to the preparation of that conference. And if you look at the conclusions of the final declaration of that conference, which was attended by about 70 countries, you recognize here many words that are in the Article 2 of the convention, actually. Now, the IPCC was tasked to suggest elements to be included in the convention, and in the appendix to the working group 3 of the IPCC, the working group 3 contribution to the first report, And that working group three mandate was to look at response strategies. I mean, the labels changed over time. Today it's mitigation, but then it was response strategies, which was broader because it included not only mitigation, but also somewhat adaptation. And here's what this appendix said about the need to stabilize atmospheric concentrations. Sustainable development requires a proper concern of environmental protection on one side, and the other side, the right balance between economic and environmental objective. You see again this tension I was mentioning. So again, the article, a second time, just to see how these were framed. So over time, the IPCC produced thousands of pages of report. These are the covers of the main report. The first report didn't say much about impacts at different temperature levels, but pointed to the fact that the rate of change, which was an issue mentioned several times over the last 2 days, is an important factor, particularly for natural terrestrial ecosystems. Then, a very significant paper published in 1991 by people who were involved in the preparation of the Norway conference, but also IPCC lead authors, was this one. You might, if you have, you have seen many times here the reasons for concern, the burning embers, and the slow evolution of colors between associated with different of risks. This is a precursor, actually, of this, and you see that they were using rate of change, but also 1 degree and 2 degree, and between 1 and 2, the 1.5 was related already to extensive damage to ecosystems and risk of instabilities. In the second assessment report, there was a lot of emphasis on the relationship between emissions and concentration and stabilization of concentration at different levels. I have to accelerate, otherwise the time will be out before I get to my conclusions. The third assessment report was asked to answer specific questions which have been written in the framework of UNFCCC and which were highly convoluted. For example, it asked the IPCC what constitutes dangerous anthropogenic interference, which is without any number in the Article 2 of the Convention. And the answer of the IPCC was basically, this would require value judgment, and it's not for us to answer. So let me go to the conclusions, and you can.
That's a question time.
Yes. You can read my conclusions during the question time, but in two words. I think much progress can still be made by IPCC in terms of policy relevance while not becoming prescriptive. Policymakers have actually many constraints to follow. There are confronted with. We just heard Harald about some of the questions that they have in South Africa. What is dangerous? What is ethical? We have multiple gases, not only CO2. For a long time, IPCC talked almost only about stabilization of CO2, cost-benefit analysis, funding priorities, co-benefits of climate measures, integration with the other 16 sustainable development goals today. Will all this get me re-elected is a key question for most policymakers. To inform better those policymakers, IPCC must improve the quality of the dialogue with policymakers, listen better to their needs, involve more disciplines in its work, particularly in social sciences, and I'm not saying this because Benito is chairing, improve cooperation across working groups, use less jargon, be clearer, particularly in its summary for policymakers, and improve its communication and outreach efforts. And finally, I think the IPCC must be more transparent about some of the details of the way it reaches its qualitative assessment, and also provides in a more transparent manner the data behind each of its table and diagram, which is not always the case. Sorry, Benito.
Thank you very much. I need to make sure that per capita time is held, so I can take one question.
No problem.
Was up there. Is it on this?
So I'm Mike Aware, Berkeley Lab. I was one of the lead authors of Chapter 12, which is the form of projections. And regarding the title, we were never really asked to begin an assessment specifically about 1.5 degrees. But if we had, we would have put a difficult spot because the secret five really had no simulations to address this, and the pattern scaling of RCP 2.6 fails. And so CMIP 6 does not address this directly. There's an effort here in Oxford that is going it to. But I think, there needs to be better coordination.
Absolutely.
People asking the questions, people doing the work. And I do not see that.
I cannot agree more with you. That's what I say. The dialogue between policymakers and the users of the IPCC assessment and the authors producing the report need to improve in quality and content. And this from the stage of the scoping. And it still needs to be improved.
Thank
I fully agree
much.
With you.
Thanks.
A very good topic.
Does this thing work?
Yeah, it's not. It doesn't
actually. Okay, just checking. So a few disclaimers before I start. I'm going to be talking about climate modeling, and I am not a modeler. But I don't think this should stop me from talking about climate modeling, especially because of the privileged position that our thinking about economics have played in how we think about mitigation pathways. So I am doing this as building a bridge from social scientists who are thinking very hard about how our imaginations about the world shape the kinds of things we pay attention to, measure, and report on in reports like the IPCC. So for the modelers out there, this is an invitation for you to meet me halfway. So we've learned a lot. If you look at the original integrated assessment modeling, they were interested in coming up with optimized pathways. They wanted to know what the most optimal, from an economic sense, pathway would be for various goals. But we've learned a lot since then. Let's not forget that. These were amazing models in 1990, but we've learned a lot. We've learned a lot about the depth of the social transformation this is going to require. This is not a technical exercise. We have seen a very limited ability to even get the kinds of changes we want already. We're talking about social reorganization and transition. I'd like to echo something Michael Grubb said today earlier about the idea of we're talking about managing a transition, not optimizing an ideal economic future that may not actually exist. There's a lot of discussion around possible win-wins of low-carbon development. People keep wanting to know, how do we get those? Are they real? Is this greenwashing? Is this just the global north saying, oh, here's a nice development pathway, do this? But we can't really assess those with the models we have. We have an amazingly increased depth of recognition of the interconnection between human and ecological well-being. So look at the work of Dasgupta, which has emerged since the early integrated assessment models, where he's saying our fundamental notion of human well-being must include natural capital, and let's put some numbers to it. This isn't just wishful thinking, this is let's seriously do some analysis here. The political challenges of getting climate action, we can't ignore this. We cannot pretend we're in a perfect world. We need information that allows us to navigate the political economy of transitions. And if we're not going to get those from our models, where are we going to get insights about the potential economic and political economy hurdles we're going to face? Finally, let's not remember, or let's not forget, the geopolitical and regional tensions around exclusion and inequity outside the climate space. Look at what's happening in America. Look at the Brexit debates. Harald and I were just talking about tensions in South Africa in terms of ongoing perceptions and realities of exclusion. Look at what's happening in Syria. We can no longer pretend that inequality is something that isn't that important in either our political decision making in climate or outside climate. So what do we really want to know now in light of these things? If we were designing a modeling world now, what would we want to know? I think we'd want to know how to manage the risks. This is an insurance and a management transition frame, not an investment optimization frame. We'd want to know things like, what are the actual human development trade-offs or potential synergies? And I don't mean abstract trade-offs where we've aggregated things. I mean real trade-offs in real policies to real people. Who exactly, in terms of political economy, are likely to win or lose from policies in terms of differentiated vulnerabilities, differentiated characteristics, and differentiated resources? So let's not forget, we're in a world of very different actors. And how might these processes of economy and economic transformation engage with other dynamics, including dynamics that are driving inequality globally and within countries? So these are some of the things I think we ought to be asking. So based on this, I am making a plea for a much more serious consideration of how we think about equity when we're talking about modeling, especially economic modeling for a 1.5, or actually any level. One, if we're serious about human development, we need to be thinking about basic human capabilities, which cannot easily be abstracted. We actually can't talk about trade-offs. You know, the great beauty of economics is it tells us we have to think about trade-offs. I completely agree. I bought it. You got me. But you can't tell me how we're going to trade things off if we're going to systematically exclude the fact that you can't even evaluate a trade-off for someone without understanding where they're coming from, without understanding the constraints they're facing. And as soon as you start to do global models which are aggregated, you lose this ability to actually seriously evaluate trade-offs, especially if you're using representative agents. So there's been a lot of modeling from people who are interested in equity, and they notice that even if you take an optimization framework for economic models and you start to disaggregate, it changes the optimization frameworks. We can't even answer those questions without talking about equity seriously. As I mentioned, the politics of getting to 1.5 or 2 or 3 are not going to be easy. And how we use equity claims is at least as important as any kind of analysis of what they, quote unquote, actually are. As Benito mentioned yesterday, equity is such a deep-seated, visceral sense that people have. And equity claims have and will be used by both sides to urge action and to prevent action. So I was just reading a bunch of claims from the American Mining Association accusing Obama of being unfair for trying to do the Clean Power Plan and for actually being morally wrong in even attempting to do so. And economic transformation is going to have economic winners and losers, and inequalities are dynamic. So let's not forget this. We're talking about a transformation, which means that we can't just assume that inequalities are going to be a deviation from baseline or we're going to calculate things. These are dynamic. If I have resources and I can invest in a new green carbon technology, I will benefit. If I don't have resources, I won't. We need to be thinking about the dynamics of inequality and how inequality actually functions. So, stepping back, I'm not a modeler, remember? So from geography, we think about equity in three main ways. Participation and procedural equity. Recognition, which is a weird one. It's asking the question, how do we characterize, imagine, or parameterize the people that we include in our analysis? And distribution. So these are the three models. Obviously, most of the modeling has happened in the distribution focus. As someone who's interested in the larger question of how would we even think about how to design a model, I'm interested in recognition. So can we, this was the question I set myself. I said, all right, I'm not a modeler. I have my qualms about IAMs to begin with, but I want to ask, can we even ask them about equity in a meaningful way? So what were the things that we would even want to recognize if we were trying to reinvent a form of modeling that was better at dealing with equity? And then can they be retrofitted or not? So let's take a step back. Let's think about all the things we've learned over 20 years of studies from all the other areas. I'm looking at development studies here, adaptation and vulnerability studies, all the political lessons where we've tried to get climate policies through and run into equity claims. Heterogeneity is the absolute base here. We have heterogeneity in terms of sensitivity to climate impacts, sensitivity to climate policy, and the ability to benefit from new opportunities. And these things don't just revolve around income. They revolve around identity. They revolve around things like gender, They revolve around a whole bundle of things which systematically we can't include in the kind of models we're doing right now. We have hugely varying human development priorities across contexts, which again fundamentally changes the goal structure of economies and even what countries want to do. And this comes back to our idea of imagination. How do we even think about imagining the economies and energy structures that people are enmeshed in? So let's think about that a little bit. When you look at the data, there's, you know, early papers from Shukla back in 1990 saying we don't even have clear conceptual models of energy structures for most of the developing world. There's been a lot of improvement in certain countries, but not across the board. Same things with economies. Are these large models often assume away unemployment if they do include them? They rarely deal with the informal economy in a substantive way, and there's whole chunks of developing world economies that may work in fundamentally different ways, but we're using models that were designed not to do those things. How does that even allow us to talk about equity if we've systematically made invisible the most vulnerable people? The question of a range of relationships of natural capital. People would say, well, everyone surely is equally impacted by natural capital. Well, no, actually. If you look at the data, we see quite clearly that there is a range of vulnerabilities and relationships with natural capital, and different people on that are going to be more or less sensitive to changes. So what I did is I went through and I asked questions like, okay, if these are the things we think we ought to be able to do or would like to do, where are we at? I'm not going to go through all of them. So I just quickly went through the literature where people have explicitly said, we're trying to deal with equity and dealing with economic models. And I don't know how I did this. I somehow forgot all the deep decarbonization pathways, Harald, so they're not in here. That was really dumb. Really sorry. So how do they deal with sensitivities to climate impacts? There's a little bit of recognition. You know, there's been a Hope, Chris Hope and the PAGE model have tried to do this. But really, we've got a long way to go. Meaningful damage functions are basically not anywhere near what's going on. Sensitivities to climate policies, there's some income-based attempts, there's some employment-based attempts, but we could do more with this, but some of these factors are almost impossible to include in the way we have it now. Ability to leverage new opportunities, I don't know of anyone who's taking that seriously. I don't know anyone who's seriously building in models of dynamic inequality. Maybe I'm wrong, but I haven't found any yet. Human development priorities, this has been better acknowledged. So you think about things like the scenarios, the socioeconomic path, shared socioeconomic pathway scenarios. They've tried to do this where they actually have models outside that they talk to each other, recognizing there's a bunch of development indicators we care about. But some of these things are still very difficult to include globally. You can do it at the regional level, but as soon as you flip up globally, you start to really have problems. And then we've already, as I mentioned already, and I won't get into this in detail, how we imagine things like our energy systems, how actual economic systems work, including informal employment and unemployment, these are up for grabs. I won't talk about communication, although it's really important. So my final thoughts on non-modeler. From the outside, and this comes back to this question about communication, seriously addressing equity is almost impossible with what we have. You could say they shouldn't even try, and I'd say, well, we have to think about that really seriously. And even though I'm running out of time, I'm going to have this one announcement before I leave. A group of us, in honor of Paul Baer, are holding a workshop in Bonn. We're calling all researchers from any discipline who are engaged in equity to join us for a workshop about how to make an equity-focused research agenda. So if you're interested, come talk to me.
Excellent. Thank you so much. I'm a modeler and an economist. I agree with your critique completely. And doing what you're talking about is possible. How do you think we can organize a community on both the economic and modeling side and on the social issue side to go after this?
Well, people need to come to the workshop. And one of the things we're doing is putting a call for proposals for the kind of research agendas people think are important. So, for instance, one of the research agendas someone might propose would be, how do we seriously get an interaction writ large and the models. That would be a great proposal, and I invite you to submit it to the workshop.
As a newbie to this area, do you think it's possible to codify equity considerations in terms of a
Sonja. No, but just stay close. Because
stay close. I'll stay close. So one of the things I study on the side is the psychology of equity and justice. And we know that people use very different arguments about justice in very different situations. So the same person might use four or five different arguments in four or five different conditions. So then trying to think about how we actually think about equity and come up with a single number seems absolutely impossible. In terms of where, when and how we should use these different adjusters, you know, there's been some interesting work. Elizabeth Stanton has done some really interesting work around this, where she's been quite critical of the way that integrated assessment models put boundaries on how they will or will not transfer funds across regions, and that has been buried in the technical details. While we've had quite a good discussion about discounting intergenerationally, there's been almost no discussion of the assumptions that many of these models make about the inability to transfer significant resources from one region to the next, which has all kinds of equity complications. So I think that A, no. B, the biggest conversation here comes back to the communication one. The model isn't just a model. A model is how it gets used. So the equity part is just as much about how it gets used as what's actually in the model. No, I agree. I mean, this is the tension of, do we keep the very simplistic models we have and try to tweak them to highlight certain equity issues, which certain people have done. Elizabeth Stanton, friend Frank Ackerman have done a great job of picking parts out and saying, look, we could do this with it. And that gets you part of the way. That gets you to distribution questions. It doesn't get you to recognition questions. Those, I think, may require other very simple models, but not the very simple models we have.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to introduce Professor Claude Henry, who is Professor of Sustainable Development at Columbia, who's also at Sciences Po in Paris. And Professor Henry, it does not refresh, not refreshing, it does not have a slide presentation, but he's going to talk to us about bottom-up push to 1.5 degrees. Thank you, Mr. Professor. You can walk around with it if you want. Or you can sit, or whatever you want to do. There you go.
Okay, thank you. My presentation will be based on work with Laurence Dubiana. That work is part of a book we prepare, and the title of a book, which will be published by Columbia University Press, is Natural Capital in the 21st Century, From Despair to Persuasion. It's clear that with climate change, disaster looms. And that is also the case with resources, natural resources like water, soil, biodiversity. In that situation, why is it the case that mankind behavior looks like the behavior of a guinea pig mesmerized by a boa? It's definitely not for want of ingenuity. We have, or we will soon have, all the instruments, be they scientific, technological, economic, managerial, legal, all the instruments necessary to face. But will we use them? Will we efficiently, properly use them? The obstacles are daunting. Are daunting because we inherit from a situation which has been characterized by two centuries of, I would say, development crystallized around plundering natural capital, or in a way which economists like, two centuries of neglecting, ignoring what we call in economics external effects. strange name. They are very, very internal to our life, and they are very, very important. Facing these obstacles, we can doubt we are able to put to use the instruments we have, and an incredible wealth of instruments. The lack is definitely not there. If you go to the 18th century, the second half of the 18th century, you have a France that is completely paralyzed by inappropriate institutions and by exorbitant privileges of the rich and the powerful. And that looked absolutely impossible to change. Very clever men tried, like Turgot, Necker. They failed. But in the background, an equally incredible mushrooming of new visions, new ideas, new initiatives, new actions was taking place. Not coordinated, but which finally converged to the end of the Ancien Régime. This is marvelously described in that other great book by Alexis de Tocqueville, L'Ancien Régime et la Révolution. If we are to go through the extreme difficulties we are in, we need a revolution. A revolution on a scale, geographic, and also on a social and economic and politic, on a scale much larger than the French Revolution of the 18th century. Can we detect now a kind of mushrooming of ideas, visions, initiatives, actions, which can be compared with what Tocqueville saw as the preparation of the French Revolution? We can. And I now use a few minutes to give a few examples. Large cities are cooperating. Well, it's a mixture of cooperation and emulation to build together more sustainable future for the cities in the world. The Deuteronomist says, man doesn't live only from bread, but he lives very much from bread, taken in a large sense. And the pricing of bread has a great influence on his behavior. That's probably the greatest weakness of the Paris Agreement, not introducing some forms of carbon pricing. But they are introduced by various actors. In Europe, in Northern Europe, various countries imitate now the example of Sweden, which is great. Even in North America, you see the introduction of some forms of carbon pricing. Think, even Alberta, land of tar sands, is now emulating British Columbia in introducing a carbon tax. This morning we heard about financial markets. It's very recent that financial markets now at last factor in climate change. And that recognition has been the start of what is called the divest invest movement, which grows at a remarkable pace. US Attorneys general attorneys in some states are now prosecuting large energy corporations for not having disclosed what they knew about the influence of climate change on their activities and their profits. So, lying to their stockholders and the regulators as well. And again, in court, but a very different way. Ordinary citizens are prosecuting public authorities for not protecting them against the consequences of climate change. In the Netherlands, in Pakistan, in the US, and other places. In the US, yes, in the US, children, well, students in high schools are prosecuting, with the help of James Hansen, are prosecuting the state of Texas. In Pakistan and in the Netherlands, the judges ruled in favor of the plaintiffs. And I will finish my list here because of him, not because of the reality of things. I will finish my list with what indigenous communities are doing to fight the plundering of natural resources, which are essential for the survival in North Dakota, in Tikal, Guatemala, in Colombia, and in the Amazonian forest with the Surui community. Laurence and I, we met Almir Surui, the chief, at the conference in Paris. We were impressed by what he does in the forest to conserve and develop and exploit in a sustainable way the forest in the spirit of what President Obama said 2 weeks ago in Hawaii. Ways consistent with ancient traditions and the best science available. Conclusion. Where is my conclusion? Here. Still, what I said is little stories compared with the scale of the obstacles. But as Svetlana Alexievich said in her Nobel conference last December, the stories that ordinary people are telling in my books are little stories. But all these little stories make big history. I will conclude by quoting possibly the best economist about inequality, formerly master of Nuffield College in Oxford, Tony Atkinson, at the beginning of his book published at Harvard University Press, Inequality, What Can Be Done? He writes, "The world faces great problems, but collectively, we are not helpless in the face of a force outside our control. The future is very much in our hands." Right, provided we don't waste any time. Don't know whether some of you read the bulletin of atomic scientists. I do. I've been a physicist before. In the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists, in each issue, you have the clock. the long arm of a clock is now 3 minutes before midnight. And, I quote, marking the dire setting of a clock since 1983 at the height of a world war. And very precise, for two reasons, climate change, uttering danger. Thank you.
Thank you very much. No, wait. Questions, who hasn't had anything to ask yet? Can I take one? There we go, Miles. We had one of them. So, first of all, a quick thanks. I owe Professor Henry for persuading one of the lost to Vienna to open an email from a professor in Oxford she'd never heard of. So, thank you for that. So I just wanted to put that out there. But I had a question. So many disruptive things are going to happen over the next 50 years. I mean, billions of people are going to move from country to city, which for those people will be a much more disruptive transition than anything I can imagine to do with climate change. So is this really such a disruption for real people that we're talking about here? Or is it just that there'll be a lot of disruption over the next 50 years? We just have to steer the disruption on a climate-friendly path.
It is already a disruption for some people, still minorities. Sorry. It is already a disruption for people, minorities. Year after year, it grows as a disruption. And it might be that the most important cause of the difficulties for people to go from the rural setting to cities will be climate change. So, how can you imagine the collision between 10 billion people on the planet and the devastation of natural resources? That's the fundamental disruption. And the people will feel it more and more, will express it with various ways. No revolution is completely peaceful, and that one will not be. And already now, it's not peaceful. More than 300 people, activists, leader of communities, journalists, have been murdered last year for fighting for sustainable development, for fighting against the destruction of their environment, their natural environment. And Chief Almir Sururi, who is such an example for a balanced way to manage tropical forest, he has on his head a contract, $100,000. He never goes in Brazil. Oh, in France, in the United States, no problem. In Brazil, he's always with two agents of special forces of a federal state. They remember the murder of Chico Mendes. There will be many Chico Mendes. There also will be many destruction on the other side. Inevitable.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I think it also needs to be kept in mind that the analogy was between the Ancien Régime and the climate problem, not the French Revolution. The French Revolution was the solution to the problem of the Ancien Régime. So, may I take this opportunity to invite John Magrath
to the podium.
John, here is your microphone.
Thank you, Benito. There was one preceding slide there.
Zero hunger, zero net emissions.
Okay. Thank you, Benito. It's terribly difficult coming towards the end of such an illuminating session because I feel that everybody has said what I wanted to say already, but said it much better than I could possibly say it. So I've been scribbling an entirely new speech on the hoof as people have been speaking. The focus of the conference has been the interactions between the SDGs and Paris, and the interactions, the progress towards, the synergies between, and the trade-offs. The questions, I think, really are coming in this session down to, but who decides on these synergies and trade-offs, and who influences who decides on those trade-offs, and how? And these are really issues of political economy, which, thankfully, have now begun to come up. And also, issues about social norms and behaviours in order to influence the politicians. And I was struck this morning, cycling into this conference, that we haven't mentioned the other big conference that, of course, is going on in Oxford at the moment, which is at Worcester College and its resurgence with Satish Kumar and other famous eco-warriors. And, you know, they are at the cutting edge, really, of attempts to change our personal behaviour, our social norms, and think about new kinds of societies. There may not be many of them, but it did seem that there was quite a gap between the hippies over there and the hard hats or the hard heads in this conference. And somewhere in that gap, there sits, you know, Joe and Josephine Public, the great mass of people. And they don't know, or they don't necessarily sympathise with either the hippies or the hardheads. So how do we approach those? How do we convince them and engage with them? And actually, I kind of include many of my colleagues in Oxfam in that. I include myself in that. I'm not a scientist. So, you know, I've sat here and, my God, you lot can do slides. I've never seen so many slides in my life. And you talk so fast, you know. It's fantastic. But it does reflect a problem of communication about how do we communicate science. Don't have any simple answers to that, but this is an attempt, really, as to how within a development agency we're trying to conceptualize for ourselves, for some of our the people we work with, just how do we think about these issues? And this very first slide, I don't know if you can see it, but it's called the donut, and it was created by a person called Kate Raworth, who describes herself as a renegade economist. She's actually a research fellow here at the ECI, and it predates, I believe, what Professor Neboya Nakichenovich was saying, and how his description of this safe and just space for humanity, it incorporates Rockstrom's planetary boundaries, but it gives a social floor or a social foundation using the SDGs, and it tries to say that it's between these boundaries in which we have that safe and just space. They're not fixed boundaries, obviously. They are flexible, they interact. This should really be a dynamic diagram which can depict the shifting and the interactions between the two. But obviously, I don't have the technology to make it dynamic. But it is a sort of mental matrix which we can use to think about how these interact. And the work that Kate has been doing and others, it leads on to the question, what is this safe and just space? It leads on to questions of what are new economics, new ways of thinking about development. What is development for? Where is it going? How do we measure it? How do we get away from measuring it in pure terms of gross domestic product, which has been the kind of, as you know, the classical way of measuring, and which omits so much else that is so important. And another of my colleagues, Catherine Trebek, who's associated with universities of West of Scotland and Strathclyde, she's just about to produce a book called Arrival, which is trying to create a new concept about where we want to get to, and it's based on the idea that in the northern societies we have, although there are questions of distribution, we have sufficient in the sense that we have managed to solve many of the questions around poverty, around hunger, and around disease. And my the second way of looking at it, let me see, what do I do, press a, go back, sure, sorry, oh, it's there, that one, okay. And this is the slide which I was originally going to talk about a little more, but I think this has been covered in such detail in this conference. I don't want to go over it, but this is a way of conceptualizing, in this case, the hunger SDG and how it might map on to net zero emissions. So as you can see, it's trying to take land use systems, food systems, energy systems, and social protection systems and fit some of the really big issues into that matrix and look at where there are predominantly synergies, we think, between the different issues, and in the case of the red typology, where there are predominantly potential conflicts. And this is probably very simple. It feels very simple after seeing all of the work that you, so many of you are engaged in. But the audience is not scientists. The audience is really for how we in Oxfam and elsewhere can think about these issues and present these to people we work with, to alliances and networks in South Africa and elsewhere. And just one on reflection, I think the one of the big issues around biofuels and BECCS, which has come up so much at this conference, is about generally about negative emissions technologies. And clearly these may be necessary, but I think we have to recognise where such things like BECCS are actually starting from. And if you look at the track record of biofuels, then the actual impact on people has been extremely detrimental in many cases. And there's an Oxfam report coming out shortly which is very critical of the EC biofuels regime. And it takes case studies from Peru, Tanzania and Indonesia, and it says these have been a disaster for people. And it is a reminder that development is not just about education or health or poverty. The development, the SDGs and the concept of development, and it's incorporated in the SDGs, is about peaceful, just and inclusive societies free from fear and violence. Well, the experience of many people and societies that have been affected by biofuels is quite the opposite. They have been subject, as you know, to coercion, to violence, to dispossession, to the corruption of law. And these are people who are on the margins of society, who, in theory, are those who should be brought first and no one should be left behind. So if we're going to pursue BECCS, or at least the bioenergy part of it, then, you know, it's not starting from a good place. And I've not seen any recognition of that political economy, those factors actually mentioned so far at this conference. And indeed, it brings about issues about what, again, do we mean by development? Because, you know, if you look, there's been a lot of attention on the possible implications of climate change in conflict in Syria and elsewhere. There's been very, very little on the way in which infrastructure, development infrastructure in the supposed national interest has been a far greater cause or likely cause of conflict over the years. Sports facilities, big dams, only two examples. Big dams responsible for perhaps 15 million people per annum internally displaced out of 47 million people who are internally displaced. And these again, you know, are possible recipes or remedies for climate change. And I think that in the haste to get to 1.5, we run serious risks of moving ahead on some of these big and supposedly very profitable ventures, which there's a lot of vested interests that are going to push these, and we are going to miss out on the people who are most seriously affected. So, finally, how I'm ahead of time. I'm ahead of myself. Am I? Okay. I'm doing this because they say everybody else has said these so much the things so much better. In a sense of going back to communicating what we want to see and where are we going and how do we bring people along, we have to have a vision which is more than let's get to 1.5 degrees. We have to have a vision about societies which are transformed and in which fundamental shifts have taken place, but people see those shifts as something that they want. And that is one of the most difficult things that we get over. At the very beginning of this conference, Laurence Tubiana, I remember saying, you know, she said that she had been cajoling, nagging, and prodding governments to sign up to the Paris Agreement, which is great, but it doesn't work with the public. You know, if somebody comes along and cajoles and nags and prods me, I am going to probably react in a not very nice way. And climate change is particularly problematic because it's terrifying. It's really frightening. You know, and if we have fear, then we respond to it in very obvious ways. Deny it, drop it, move away, drop out, or retaliate. And so we have to find a way of framing all of these issues in ways that are give hope, give reassurance to people that life will be better. And if we can do that, if we can move towards a sense of arrival in which we have societies with perhaps more substance and less stuff, then hopefully we can see that change can happen very fast indeed. Thank you. Oh, sorry. We've heard a lot, haven't we, about the NDCs. They're not going to get us there yet, and they have to be fully implemented. I think the key thing that we have to do, and I don't know how this is going to be done, but is actually to create people's participation in the process of making the NDCs happen, making them stick, and making them more ambitious. So it's about organisations, movements, networks becoming involved in the process of the NDCs. The other thing that actually you said I had in mind was thinking of originally was actually how it to get to climate change goals you actually might be better off not mentioning climate change. And I think some of the best examples of behavioural change with possibly, you know, very conservative audiences have been around, say, reducing waste. And it's actually about starting where people are with their values and what they see as important and obliquely introducing climate change as one of the further down the line.
All right. So you're losing out now.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Therefore, I guess, I wonder how you see this, from your perspective, should we not frame X as how can we make bioenergy work even in a 1.5 degree world?
I mean, yes, I suppose that is a possibility. I don't discount that BEX may actually be good in some situations. I am very distrustful of it because I think the experience of biofuels certainly is that...
No.
Okay, sorry.
Please, just because we have to get on.
Yeah. Okay, no, actually, we'll stop. I'll come to have a chat with you afterwards if we're running short of time.
Thank you, Benito. Thank you all for sticking through the end of this this session. I mentioned yesterday afternoon in the plenary the notion that, and I think it's true, that the focus of the Framework Convention on common but differentiated responsibilities among nations, which has driven, of course, the focus of the political process, of the IPCC's responses and information into the political and policy process, has in some ways driven our filters to look at national responsibilities, somewhat to the exclusion of the responsibilities of non-state actors. I think it's helpful as we think about and try to understand what our theory of change is, essentially, with respect to the transition to a decarbonized economy, what the role of non-state actors may be. And I think there's some lessons to be drawn from related domains. This is a figure looking over time at the decline in deforestation from the mid-2000s of something on the order of 70%, really to present day, in the Brazilian Amazon. A decline that those of us who are working in this region and on this topic did not anticipate. A decline that still has more room to go. But nonetheless, if you look at the drivers of this decline, there are many drivers on the policy process, international support, public attention. But the scholarly literature that's now looking backwards at what drove this decline has really pointed to a predominant role of essentially a civil society engagement of major industry. So the increase in deforestation leading up to 2000 was primarily driven by expansion of soy into the Amazon forest region in Brazil. And around 2006, Greenpeace engaged in a very public campaign with Cargill, the major trader of soy products, and with McDonald's, a major purchaser of soy products, in a way that came at a moment in which Brazilian civil society, and more broadly civil society, was responsive to that pressure. And those companies saw that their social license was essentially at risk, and worked together with many others to agree to a voluntary soy moratorium that exists to this day, such that soy, which was the major driver of deforestation, is now a very modest driver of deforestation in the Brazilian Amazon. Again, just one example, but nonetheless an example that really came largely outside the formal policy process, came through a civil society engagement with industry. And so as we look at not the land use side of the equation, but the energy side of the equation, I think it's helpful to take a look at the role of the fossil energy industry in climate change and the opportunities for the industry to become active and engaged players in the response. What first drew my attention to this was a body of research published by my colleague Richard Heady, who did an analysis looking at the amount of coal, oil, and natural gas extracted from the ground on an annual basis by individual fossil energy companies since the middle of the 19th century, essentially the dawn of the Industrial Revolution, and found that, so the blue line is the amount of carbon dioxide and methane that's been released globally from emissions of fossil fuels and cement production over this time period. The red is the proportion that can be traced back to just 90 major companies, investor-owned companies, state-owned companies. And what he found was basically that two-thirds of all industrial emissions could be traced to just 90 entities. Now, obviously, the size of the contribution to the problem, we're all purchasers of that energy. It doesn't define their responsibilities per se. But in my view, and Naomi Oreskes and I and Richie have written on this, the question really then becomes, well, what did companies do in light of the evidence of the risks of their products? How did they respond? Not to say that they had sole responsibility, but one could look at their distinctive responsibilities in light of the evidence of the risks, what they did in that response. I think it's very now well now documented in a range of sources. I'm simply pointing to a report that my organization, the Union of Concerned Scientists, released last year, which is compiling a lot of information on what fossil energy companies did basically in the early 1990s, 1989, formed the Global Climate Coalition. For many years thereafter, engaged both as individual companies and as coalitions of companies through various lobbying groups in looking to sow misinformation about the risks of climate change, primarily to slow regulation, not exclusively, but primarily focused in the United States. Just to give you one example of this, so this is an internal communications memo from the American Petroleum Institute published, or actually was actually written up, but not released until some years later, 1998. This was around the time of the debate in the United States Congress about ratifying the Kyoto Protocol. So this is a communications memo, which was then followed by a significant amount of financial investment to have it be operationalized, in which they identified that victory will be achieved when average citizens understand uncertainties in climate science, recognize those uncertainties become part of the conventional wisdom. I'll just scroll down to the bottom of this. Those promoting the Kyoto Treaty on the basis of extant science appear to be out of touch with reality. This was an industry-wide communications campaign that took place in the context of debate over whether the United States should engage in the Kyoto process. Well, as you know, this was a successful effort on the part of the community, that there was a strong pushback. The United States did not ultimately engage in the Kyoto Treaty. And you know, there was a diversity of responses within the industry at the time. So again, this is at that same time period, some companies began to pull away from this effort to sow doubt about the risks of their process, of their product. So BP and followed by Shell left the Global Climate Coalition in, around that time. John Brown, later Lord Brown, gave a very prominent speech at Stanford in 1997. There's now an effective consensus among world-leading scientists of discernible human influence on the climate. It'd be unwise for us as a company to ignore those dangers, the mounting concern. We and BP alone could not resolve the problem. It does not mean we should do nothing. We have a responsibility to act, and BP accepts this responsibility. This was right after the second assessment report was released. There was a short-lived period of time when BP became rebranded as Beyond Petroleum, and really, I think quite seriously, sought to rethink what its energy strategy would be. But as the Kyoto process failed, as a price on carbon did not materialize, they reverted back to being basically an oil and gas company. And if you move forward to today, basically, companies by and large, investor-owned companies, acknowledge climate risks. ExxonMobil on their website says rising greenhouse gases pose significant risks to society and ecosystems. There's no misrepresenting the state of the science in this case. But last year, many companies still continue to participate in trade associations and lobbying groups. I'm now putting this in a very much of an American domestic context, which of course is influential with respect to the global response to climate change. In which they belong to, this just gives you a kind of a Venn diagram view of major trade associations and lobbying groups in which companies play leadership roles. The American Petroleum Institute, the Western States Petroleum Association, which is very much focused on California and the West, the American Legislative Exchange Council, or ALEC, which some of you may know, spends a lot of time briefing state legislators in the US on misinformation on climate. They continue to do so to this day, in order to encourage state legislators to roll back clean energy policies at a state level. So on the one hand, you have messaging about climate science consistent with risks at a kind of public level, but continued engagement with lobbying efforts to do exactly the opposite. This is ALEC's representation of climate change a historical phenomenon, the debate will continue on the significance of natural and anthropogenic contributions. Truthy, but not true. And then, of course, if you look at the way in which companies, what their business models look like. All right, so some companies make projections of what the future of our reliance on fossil energy will be. You all are familiar with IEA 450. BP, through 2035, projects essentially a business as usual increase in emissions associated with the burning of fossil fuels. All right. I know we have a colleague from Shell here, so you'll be familiar with the oceans and mountains scenarios. Now, Shell this year has come out with a post-Paris, somewhat more aggressive reductions pathway, but still one that, even as it reaches decarbonization towards the latter part of the century, is well above a 1.5 or 2-degree budget. This is Exxon's projection. And I would say that companies may well be right in their projections of what our future reliance on fossil energy will be. But if they are right, it will be not in small part due to the historic, and in some cases continued, role that they're playing in seeking to avoid regulation of carbon emissions. So they're not independent actors in their evaluation of the future of our reliance on fossil fuels. I think there's a role for civil society in a variety of forms to begin to ask what we should expect responsible companies to do. What would a responsible fossil energy company look like? And this is, of course, a conversation that's taking place, as have already been identified, in investment and divestment and a broad range of circumstances. So I'll just quickly scroll through these. One might expect companies to stop supporting disinformation, to unequivocally support sensible climate policies, to align their business models with a carbon-constrained world, to fully disclose financial, physical risks of climate change to their products, or to their essentially to their business, and perhaps most complicated is to pay a fair share of climate damage and adaptation costs. Right, so this is a kind of a portfolio of what society might expect. I do want to point out that social pressure, social engagement can affect companies in, I would argue, constructive ways. Last year, both BP and, thank you very much, to Shell, left the American Legislative Exchange Council, agreed to no longer participate in it. And this came out as a result of dialogue at a very senior level. It also came out as a result of very active civil society engagement. This is an example of a social media campaign. Several hundred thousand of these reached Shell management. Companies are responsive, those who want to be seen as good actors, to civil society engagement. And one can think about ways to engage them further. There are plenty of opportunities and kind of a range of things that are happening. Science-based targets initiative by the World Resources Institute and others, calling on companies to make their own equivalent of NDCs, essentially. 170, 180 companies have now engaged, some major multinationals, Coca-Cola and others. No fossil energy company has yet agreed to participate in this. I think there's some room to do so. And I'll just quickly mention that we're putting out at UCS shortly, next month, a kind of ranking, a scorecard of how companies are doing across these range of criteria, looking primarily at companies with large US investments. So this is a little advanced notice. Companies' statements on science and the need for emissions reductions, Shell does quite well. Relative to others. I won't go into detail on this. If you look at participation in trade associations and lobbying groups, not so well. But this, again, is one independent opportunity to evaluate how companies do across a range of criteria, to engage in a public, an investor, civil society dialogue, and a dialogue, of course, directly with companies about ways that they can improve their behavior relative to what we as a society might reasonably expect in the context of a post-Paris world in which we're living. So I'll just share with you this, I don't know if you can see this, a New Yorker cartoon, end on a high note. Yes, the planet got destroyed, but for a beautiful moment in time, we created a lot of value for shareholders. That's obviously not a place we want to go, and so thank you very much for listening.
going to do a bit of intergenerational justice here, because usually the last speaker is the one who gets squeezed. Okay, so officially you're actually out, but I'm going to give you three questions anyway. You get there, you go. So, questions, please. Yes.
I'm thinking about the tobacco impact. We heard today at this meeting that it's very important that the newly emerging economies and developing countries don't follow the track of the previously industrialized countries and go to the fossil fuel route, but they bypass the fossil fuel route and move to alternative energy. But I'm asking about the policy of the oil companies, and will they then do what the tobacco companies do? Do you begin to behave properly or comply at home and expand their markets elsewhere?
Well, of course, these are multinational companies, so their behavior internationally matters, of course. My own view is that the challenge is largely a U.S. one, not singularly, of course, but that because of the politics in the United States and the influence of some companies, certainly in U.S. policy, that their political influence currently exists to constrain our engagement in participating fully in the outcomes of the Paris Agreement and establishing congressional policies, for example, that would put a price or a limit on carbon, and that ultimately this kind of civil society engagement, a recognition that companies have a social license and that folks can engage with them in a meaningful way to move it into a more positive direction. My hope is that it will continue to influence their behavior in the United States, that others will pick this up in international domains, and that ultimately, for example, investors and shareholders will have a large say on how companies behave, not just in the United States, but globally. So there is that risk, but I think we have to be mindful of that as we live into this kind of body of work.
Okay, Eric, question?
You've probably seen a report by Oil Change showing that the existing infrastructure the industry deserves exceeds the 2-degree carbon budget, and messages this is an industry that has to go into a wind down as a finite life. How do we shift the conversation from the they should play nicer to, you know, we need to drive this transition completely out of forward? And by the way, we did a similar study for the electric power sector, same message.
Yeah. Well, look, if the industry had invested seriously in carbon capture and storage 20 years ago, for example, when the evidence of the products became really well known, we might be in a different place in terms of what a successful strategy might look like consistent with the carbon constraints that we're now living into. Ultimately, it's hard to say what the future of current fossil energy company looks like, what the business model looks like 20 years from now. Obviously, folks in the more forward-looking companies, I certainly include Shell in that, are wrestling with that. And are exploring different opportunities to engage. I don't think it looks anything like what it looks like today, and whether they can profitably close down those facets of their business, which are no longer consistent with constraints on carbon emissions, and perhaps find other ways to engage productively, it's hard to say. I don't think any of us have a good model for that. I do know, though, that these companies have tremendous technical and financial resources to put towards addressing this problem, should they choose to do so. So I'm open to that.
And finally, yes.
I just wanted to ask how you feel 1.5 as an outcome coming out of Paris has affected both the public and civil society, as well as the fossil fuel companies' kind of attitudes. Did it actually have any resonance? And moving forward, we saw with 2 degrees that they kind of put some of the backwards and forwards as a kind of rubbish of respect and trying in different ways, and seemed to come to a position of respect, partly because we have so much diplomatic mobilization around Paris. How do you think you can protect 1.5 and make it something that doesn't become rubbish and becomes respect?
I wish I knew the answer to that.
What experience have you had so far with
Well, some companies, and I would just include Exxon and Chevron, US-based companies, have essentially ignored Paris altogether, leaving aside whether we're looking at 2 or 1.5. Other companies are beginning to articulate the need to reduce emissions consistently with something like at least a 2-degree pathway. But we're going to have to move them further along over the next couple of years. And I think investors and investment activists and publicity will have a lot to play in how they end up stepping forward.
Thank you very much. Thank you.